Welcome to RGSL. Riga Graduate School of Law is not just a simple university. It is a university where international environment and individual approach meet. Come and see.
I think we could say that the main principles is the student involvement in various levels, both in the study process and actually the running of the school. If we can start from very much of the structure, the students are always involved in the work of the Senate and the work of Constitutional Assembly. These are the two bodies which determine the strategy of the school, determine the study programs, the content of the study programs. So the student voice is very much waited for. The students have even the better possibility in these two bodies. So this is from the structure point. Also, we very much assure the students are represented in also some arguable cases, for instance, an arbitration, academic arbitration panel, where the cases of plagiarism might come up or some other complaints. So there's always student representation in these various bodies which regulate the school's work. The students are always able to reach anyone from administration to get answers from the daily basis. They don't have to, I don't know, wait for 2-3 days and try to catch someone in the study department. They also can come to administration with their either complaints or with their ideas. In our case, we always even push students for communication, for challenging even the professors.
When you're going, for example, through a hallway, somebody from the administration says hi and just asks, how are you doing? How are you enjoying a course? And, you know, I think that is very important.
So coming from the sector of security, first thing you do is intelligence. So you try to work with open sources and try to gather as much information from the students as they would like to volunteer to try to understand their professional goals or where they are trying to go with this, as well as to try and understand these specific facets of their personalities, of their interests, and their character. For example, asking and finding out what kind of different languages do they speak. Even though in our school the working language is English, I frequently enjoy knowing if someone knows, let's say, French or Japanese or another language, and that could be very pertinent, especially if we look at some documents of international organizations, national policy papers. This information that usually, let's say, with only one set of languages, individual student could not find out. But also this is a way how to harness this diversity and show students that there is this ability to use these different kinds of things and use them to greater results rather than if you just had a one-track mind. We had the opportunity, for example, to prepare for moot courts or for debate in the silent room. We had the library just in a hand's distance, and at the same time we could gather and discuss these strategies, different arguments, and do that in this almost an otherworldly feeling. You are in the silent room in the middle of the school. At the same time, you have all the resources around you. At the same time, you are not disturbed. So that is fantastic for these. It's also in the way how you can organize the room and the way how you can organize the tables, use multimedia, use presentations, and different kinds of digital and real ways of illustrating information. And that is very important so that students would have a very creative process. They would have to think what is the best way how to get their argument through. Diversity, transparency, and results.
The school and the environment were pretty relaxing as well. You don't have much pressure coming from students or from teachers, any negative thing coming into the academic course. And the teachers were always open, as much as the students, so we don't have any difficulties really integrating. Maybe this psychological help, because you have to see what's happening behind the screen, behind the camera. Most of the time, maybe 90%, maybe more, of students in remote classes do not turn on the cameras. You can only hear them, and you don't know what they're doing, you know, when you're speaking, basically, when you're lecturing. If you have a, you know, physical class, person-to-person class, You can see what's wrong when looking at someone's eyes. There needs to be a proactive way of engaging with psychological support, because you can't wait for students to come. You have to look at what's happening. So maybe the administration could be more proactive. I don't say they aren't, because my Erasmus coordinator was really proactive, trying to make these contacts. Maybe you have to say if that's the case. Maybe you're not, you know, accompanied enough, and you have to ask for support, not only for yourself, but for the others, in case, you know, prevention. So flexibility, practice, and seriousness. You know, international law and European Union law are pretty broad, but you look into it with very serious ways, you know, in case studies, and you don't stop at the articles.
When students came with an initiative to make a podcast, RGSL was very supportive of the decision, and now we have a podcast already for half a year, and everything that was needed is being provided to us, and I think it is amazing.
I think we can easily walk into the director's office and be like, hey, I want an internship. I know we don't have anything that's out there right now, but do you have somebody? And like, we will look at it, we will take that student's case and find that student an internship somewhere. But it's just a matter of them knocking on the door that's probably already open. It's just a matter of taking that step. And I think that's encourageable as sort of a student development. And again, if we come back to student-centered learning, this is student-centered professional development almost. You know, like, you're not only helping them study what you're doing here, you're helping them more in terms of personal growth, in terms of confidence, and everything else that they need once they leave RGSL, or in terms of what they're doing on top of their RGSL work and studies. I also ask my students at the beginning of the course, what do they expect? And then I try to tell them whether part of the course is going to be what they expect, and or whether they should expect something else. But also sometimes there's something that they would like to integrate more into the course. That's something that's been dragging over from other courses, and they see a relation to what you're doing now. But again, it's a matter of how do you get the students to freely voice their expectations and the different methods. You need to sort of have some sort of actual contact with the students, whether it is to be an open discussion, whether it is to be friendly with them, be able to joke with them on something, just to vouch a little bit better where they are on things. Because I believe that when you have a course, you obviously have a certain plan, but that plan doesn't always need to be implemented in the same way. So for example, I believe that it's okay to cover a little bit less in terms of how many topics you cover, but cover some of them a little bit deeper, if that is what will help your students understand things better. For RGSL, this works because we're not an exact sciences university. For exact sciences, this would be quite difficult, but I think that is something that can indeed make the study process a little bit more student-focused. Specialized, personal, and unique. I'll go with that.